Hello students, welcome to NIOS studio. I, Dr. Gitika Datta, Principal Bhavans Lilavati Munshi College of Education, Bharati Vidya Bhavan, New Delhi. I am here to discuss a very important topic, that is personality, self-concept and classroom motivation. Now, I would like to ask you a question. Have you ever wondered how are people different from each other? What distinguishes one person from the other? What distinguishes you from your own friend? Why do different people behave differently in different situations? Now, the situation may be the same, but different people behave in a different manner. Why does this thing happen? We are all human beings. There have to be, we are all created alike. We all have same physical features, but every one of us is considered to be different. Why? Can you list out the characteristics which set you different from your friends or siblings? You must have heard your parents saying, This, you are like this, but your brother or sister is not like that. He or she is different from you in some other manner. So how these differences arise? How do you know what belongs to this list and what not? So if I'm asking you to make a list of your own personal characteristics, what would you put in that list? And if I ask you to make a list for your friend or your brother or a sister, is this list going to be the same? So it's not. Is my behavior repetitive? That means, can people who know me very well, can they actually predict my behavior? Are there any guiding forces within me, ourselves, which guide or direct me and others' behavior? So what are these factors? If there are any forces, what are those forces which actually direct my behavior? And do I know, or will I be in a given, can I predict my own behavior in a given circumstance? So these are some of the questions which basically pertain to personality. Key, what kind of a person I am, what kind of a persona I am having, and how do people differ from each other? It is basically because of personality. Let us try to look into the definitions of personality. The distinctive and relatively enduring ways of thinking, feeling and acting that characterize a person's responses to life situations. So basically we are talking of three things: thoughts, feelings and actions. So these are the three most important components of personality. Another definition, let us see. Individuals' unique and relatively stable patterns of behavior, thoughts and feelings. So basically, again, these are unique and stable patterns of behavior, thoughts and feelings. So again, we are talking about the thinking, feeling and action. So it's basically, you can say, a mixture of all of these things which sets each and every person different from others. So this is what personality, or this is a definition of personality. Let us try to understand personality in a little bit detail. Now, each one of us, each one of you, each one of your peer group, they are characterized by a kind of a behavior. Now, this behavior is basically directed by the components of identity, that is, how am I as a person, and our behavior is, this identity is basically perceived, or it is perceived to be happening because of internal reasons, which are things which are internal to me. It is not basically because of things which are happening in the environment. Environment is there, or maybe the same for everybody, but our own responses to the environment may not be the same. And these internal causes are happening, or basically our behavior is all, it's perceived to be a very well structured and organized structure. So it governs our behavior, and all of these components of these internal causes, they are basically become a part of our personality. Self-concept, in this particular session, we'll be discussing about two things, two important aspects of personality, that is self-concept and motivation. Now, first of all, we'll discuss self-concept in brief. Question, supposing if I ask you, who are you? So, an answer which may be given to me by a three-year-old should be something like that. I am Vikram, I am 3 years old and I love my tricycle. It was given to me by my grandmother and I love playing with my friends. Another girl who is, say, 4 years old, I am Ranjana, I am 4 years old, I have a new red racket and I like playing with it. I don't want to share it with others. Now, answers by a typical 3 to 5 year olds are based on Features like name, physical appearance, sex, possessions, likings, dislikings, emotions, attitude, etc., etc. So they are more concrete in nature rather than abstract understanding of our own self. Now, if we look into the definition of self-concept, the set of attributes, abilities, and values that an individual believes or defines who he or she is. If you look into the characteristics, it is the overall image and awareness that we have of ourselves, perceptions of I and me, feelings, beliefs, values, attitudes, perceptions about our own self, and it is comprised of a variety of selves. Now, if we look into the relative understanding of self-concept vis-a-vis the environment, so we see here in the middle self-concept, and this self-concept is governed by the phenomenal self, that is basically the way I see myself operating in the environment, and the phenomenal environment is something which is the overall environment which is around us. This phenomenal environment acts upon me, and this phenomenal self is basically me in collaboration with the environment, and self-concept is basically who I am. Now, development of self-concept is how does self-concept develops. Now, self-concept is a continuous process of development. As soon as a baby is born, baby starts interacting with the environment, and based on the environment or the reactions received from the environment, the baby starts seeing themselves as different individuals. And it's a continuous process. It's an ever-evolving process. If you ask a person, who are you, say a child who is 5 years old, a child who is 10 years old, or a 15-year-old adolescent, you will see that the way they perceive themselves, it differs. Initially, we see ourselves in very concrete terms, and later on, our thoughts, our feelings, our values, they keep on adding to our concept of self. Continuous self-evaluation in different situations, verbal and non-verbal reactions of different people, significant people in our lives, like parents, teachers, friends, families, etc., their academic achievement, self-concept and culture, role of reinforcements and feedback, self-concept in an inclusive classroom. Okay, let us try to understand the main causes of or how the development of self-concept takes place. So, it is basically based on the continuous self-evaluation in different situations, verbal and non-verbal reactions of significant people in our lives, for example, teachers, parents, friends, families, etc., our academic achievement of children, which is a very important aspect because somehow teachers and parents tend to put a lot of emphasis on the academic achievement. So, a child who is doing well is likely to develop a positive self-concept, whereas vice versa for the other children. Self-concept and culture. Our cultural influences also, influence the development of self-concept. Culturally, there are certain cultures which are collectivistic in nature, and there are certain cultures which are individualistic in nature. So, individualistic cultures tend to create an individualistic kind of self-concept, like they will be talking about I, me, myself, whereas the cultures which are kind of collectivist, the children in those cultures will see themselves as part of the group. I belong to so and so family, I come from this particular place, I belong to this class, So, they see themselves as part of the whole, rather than in individualistic way, they see themselves that the individual person. Okay, let us try to see the role of reinforcement and feedback. We will be discussing about the role of reinforcements or the concept of reinforcement later on in this particular session. So, yes, reinforcement, they do help develop positive self-concept. Anything good a person does, if those efforts are rewarded and acknowledged, it contributes to development of a positive self-concept. Now, if we see the self-concept in an inclusive classroom, now in an inclusive classroom, we may have number of children or children from different diverse backgrounds, children from low socioeconomic status, children from say culturally or linguistically backward areas or backward backgrounds, or children with special needs. Now, as teachers, we need to see that self-concept of each of these children, develops in a positive manner. And how can we do that? We'll be discussing these things, because school play and teachers play a very, very important role in developing the self-concept. And if a teacher start degrading a person or a student in the class, it has a multiple, you can say it has a lot of impact on the development of self-concept of a person. Okay. Now, let us see, how do we develop a positive self-concept? So these are some of the very, you can say, strategies which are considered to be extremely helpful in developing a positive self-concept: collaborative and cooperative activities. So children, when they are working in groups, they interact, they talk, they share their feelings, they share their successes, failures, etc., and experiences. It gives a boost to their self-concept. Giving chances of success to each and every child, this is extremely important. All of us need to feel good about our own self, and this feeling good about our own self gives rise to a positive self-concept. Development of empathy also helps. The moment we start thinking from the other's point of view, and this something, thinking from the other's point of view, does not come very naturally to children, especially young children. So feelings of empathy have to be developed. So with the help of various role plays, stories, and general discussions, etc., introspective and reflective activities, asking children to think about number of things when they felt very good about themselves, their experiences of success, their experiences of failures, the activities which they like doing, the activities which they do not like doing, and why do they like doing certain things, what food items they like, why do they like those things, why they do not like such things. So all of these things have to be considered, or they have to be done in the class in order to foster a positive self-concept. And giving degrees of freedom, giving, not imposing too many things upon children, giving them relative degrees of freedom can help, and they do help the children in becoming independent and developing a positive self-concept. Another thing is giving individualized learning opportunities also. So when we are talking of our teaching learning experiences in an overall manner, we have to need to have a mix of everything. We need to have collaborative activities, we need to have individualized activities, we also need to have teacher directed activities. So basically it's about giving a kind of a holistic learning environment to the children. Now the bottom line is, which I would want to emphasize again, that each and every child needs to feel good about himself or herself, and for good reasons. Now if the students are also very smart, if the teacher says, okay, I will go on praising each and every child just like that, it does not work. Children are smart enough to understand that ma'am ya sir jo hai, they are not giving, or they are not praising, they are not being truthful about it. So we have to think about, we have to generate, valid reasons for making each and every child feel good about himself or herself. Okay, now let us come to another very important topic of discussion, that is classroom motivation. Again, I will ask with a few questions. I'll start with a few questions. Now, have you ever thought about your own self? Why do some students choose some particular subject areas and leave others? Why do some students focus on their homework while others on TV or sports? In a classroom, some students are focused on task at hand while others are just going through it half-heartedly. Now, as teachers or as would-be teachers or as students during your student life, you must have come across these things. Many of you would belong to this category or that category, but this happens. Some students enjoy reading fiction or poems while others find them so boring. And some may find doing mathematics problems very interesting, and others may find them to be a Herculean task. Why? Why does this happen? Okay, there are certain inherent, innate qualities. But yes, another very important factor is motivation. How motivated you are to do a particular task. Now, motivation is a Latin word which is derived from the word mover, which means to move. So basically something which drives a person. Motivation is defined as an internal state that arouses, directs, and maintains behavior. It is defined as a process that influences the direction, persistence, and vigor of goal-directed behavior. So if we look into the definition, it's basically the internal state that arouses, directs, and maintains behavior. So we are something which pushes us, that is motivation. So now we'll try to see what pushes us and what different types of motivations are there. There are two types: intrinsic and extrinsic motivation. Now, intrinsic motivation is motivation associated with activities that are their own reward. Somebody is intrinsically interested in doing mathematics. say, for example, let us take example. Say, for example, a parent says, ki if you do these 10 questions, I will give you a chocolate or I'll give you a toy. And the child is doing in order to get that toy or in order to get that chocolate. Now, is this intrinsic motivation or is this intrinsic motivation which is created by external factors such as rewards and punishments? So, the child would want to have that toy and that is why the child is motivated to do that task. That's extrinsic motivation. And somebody who is innately interested in doing things, that is intrinsic motivation. Something which that is there within the child which moves that person to do that particular act or that behavior, that's intrinsic. So, being teachers, our objective has to be that let our students be intrinsic motivated learners rather than extrinsic motivated learners, because learning which comes from within or the motivation which comes from within is considered to be more. Okay. Now, let us try to see or understand the dynamics of motivation in classroom. How do we create or how do we motivate our children to learn? So, first of all, let us create an environment in the class, the physical environment with adequate light, peace and proper use of colors. The physical environment has to be inviting, it has to be interesting. Now, it's our common, it's our day-to-day experience that if our physical environment is not very good, if there is too much of clutter, if there is not enough space, if there is not enough, lighting, it hampers, we do not feel like doing certain things. So, at least is the bare minimum requirement that a physical environment has to be there, enough light has to be there, there shouldn't be too much of noise or sound around, and there should the use of proper colors, too garish colors also not very good. The depending upon the level of children, say if we are talking of smaller children, class 1, class 2 children, so the walls have to be nicely decorated with colorful pictures and other things. And as the children grow, the walls can be subtle, but yes, proper use of colors should be there. Sublimation of innate impulses. Now, small children, especially younger children, they have this innate impulse of standing up and getting moving around here and there. So, education or processes of education do require that children need to control their, or how teachers are able to control the innate impulses of children. So, we have to make our things more interesting. If you are wanting to make your child learn certain things, you have to give a very interesting start for each and every lesson. That something which creates an inquisitiveness in the mind of the child, something which creates a kind of a curiosity in the mind of the child. So, that thing will give a kind of a motivating push to the child to learn. Okay, let us see what is happening in this class. Another very important thing, variation in the stimuli presented. Now, this is a psychological fact that attention span of all people is very limited and attention span of small children is especially very limited. Small children cannot concentrate on any one particular stimuli for more than a few minutes, okay, an average child. So, the thing is now if say for example, one class is supposed to be of say 35 to 40 minutes. Now, we cannot expect children to be focusing on the same stimuli. Stimuli means what kind of presentation we are giving to the parents, the children. Say for example, if a teacher is speaking and she keeps on speaking for 10, 15, 20 minutes, the child, especially smaller children, will lose interest because it is a psychological fact that children cannot concentrate on any one thing for more than a few seconds. So, the teacher needs to keep on varying the stimuli. At one point of time she is talking, at one point of time she is doing some activity, at another point of time she is asking the students to speak. So, some changes in the stimuli need to be there. So, we can have changes with respect to movements, teacher movements as well as student movements. So, teacher can be moving around, so it keeps as it is movements of the teacher within the class, it accentuates learning. Student movement also, meaningful student, it's not like that. The students are moving here and there on their own will. The teacher needs to regulate the movements of the students and tell them ki this at various points now these two students are going to help me with putting up of this chart, or this particular child is going to do the calculation on the board. So, some kind of regulated student movement that also keeps the interest alive. Gestures of the teacher. saying everything, gestures includes facial expressions also. So a teacher keeps on saying the same things in a monotonous manner with an expressionless face is not going to work with children. So the teacher has to be very expressive, smiling, and with lot of body movements and gestures, the teacher can make the things very interesting. So stories, especially they work very well with children. The stories which are done with lot of gestures, movements, and facial expressions, voice modulation, it helps. Interaction style means what kind of interaction is happening in the class. Teacher to the whole group, teacher to one student, students within themselves, one student to the other student. I mean, there should be a change in the interaction style in the class over a period of time. Voice modulation is again very important. Voice modulation means your highs and lows in the voice. Now, if you say, if I keep on saying the same thing in a same monotonous pitch, it will tend to get very boring for anybody. So teachers, especially since they are dealing with children, they have to have a very expressive voice. It's basically expression in the voice. So you need to have the highs and lows, the expressions, in order to keep your students involved. Pauses. Now, it's not that you keep on going in the same flow throughout these 35 to 40 minutes in a class. There should be pauses, meaningful pauses. Now, what is the importance of meaningful pauses? When you have these pauses, it gives the time to students to assimilate, to take in whatever has happened. Now, it's very easy for the teacher to go on and on and on about things, but it is difficult for the students to take in. Students require that time in order to take in those things. So pauses is very important. Focusing. Now, if there are certain important points, say for example, certain important topic is there, concept is there, or these are the few important points which the students need to keep in mind, the teacher needs to make the students attend to those points. He or she needs to say, students, we are doing this, and especially pay attention to this. If a teacher is showing, say, some kind of an audio, so audio may the teacher needs to tell the students, in this audio you need to pay attention to, say, whatever. You need to pay attention to the person's voice or the number of points he or she is making, so that students are, their attention is directed towards that particular direction. Next point is audio-visual switching. There has to be a good amount of audio visuals. At one point of time, students are listening to certain things. At one point of time, the students are seeing certain things. So it helps. So if a teacher is speaking and then after some time she shows them a chart or some other picture or some specimen, it helps the children in maintaining the interest level in the class. Okay, let us talk about reinforcements and punishments. Reinforcers are considered to be very important. Now, what are reinforcements? Reinforcement is basically when we want to motivate somebody into doing a desirable act. Say, for example, a student has done very good, a student has given me a very good answer, and I want to appreciate, so that this student also gets motivated to answer in the same good manner again, and other students should also be motivated to answer in a nice manner. So I say, very good, your answer is very good. So this is a kind of a positive reinforcement, ki when we are wanting to motivate or when we are wanting to strengthen the behavior of the child, so we need to do the reinforcement. Now, reinforcements are of two types, positive reinforcement and negative reinforcement. Positive reinforcement is when we are strengthening the behavior by presenting a desired stimulus after the behavior. Now, we need to understand the difference between positive and negative reinforcement. We are adding something new in the environment which was not there after a desirable behavior has happened. Say, for example, a student has given me a very good answer. The behavior has happened. So, I am introducing a positive stimulus that is very good. Now, this is a positive stimulus, and this will lead to satisfaction or happiness on the part of the child. So this is positive reinforcement. Positive reinforcement is we are adding a positive stimulus in the environment so that the probability of this behavior giving good answer increases in future. Whereas negative reinforcement is when we are strengthening the behavior by removing an aversive stimulus. Say for example, a child is there at home, and the parent is continuously nagging ki you need to clean up your room, clean up your room, and the child cleans up the room and this nagging stops. So this is negative reinforcement. That is, we are taking away something aversive from the environment, and it leads to again satisfaction. The child is happy. Okay, so positive reinforcement and negative reinforcement are both about giving satisfaction to the child in order to strengthen the desirable behavior of a child. So positive reinforcement is adding a positive stimulus. Negative reinforcement is we are taking away an aversive or negative stimulus from the environment in order to give satisfaction and increase the probability or strengthening of the behavior. Now let us try to understand punishments. What are punishments? Punishment is generally introduction of an aversive stimulus in the environment which was not earlier there. For example, a child has got very bad marks, okay, and the parent says that, okay, since you have got very bad marks, now use of punishments are basically when we are adding something in the environment which is aversive, which is not liked by the student, or there is something which we take away something which is positive from the environment. So punishments are of two types, the presentation punishment and removal punishment. Now let me take an example. Say for example, a parent is there and the child is there. The child has scored very bad marks in some exam. The parent says, since you have got very bad marks in the examination, so from now onwards, you will not watch the TV. The TV is banned for you. Now, what kind of, is this a punishment? Yes, it's a punishment. It's basic punishment. The basic idea of punishment is that we are doing something in order to make the person feel bad. So the parent is wanting the child to feel bad about it. So the parent has taken away something from the environment, that TV. Watching of TV was a positive stimulus in the environment which was already there. So the parent has taken away that. So that is a removal type of punishment. Or the parent says, now from now onwards, you will not go out and play with your friends. So the child who was already playing with their friends on a daily basis, so that now this restriction is there, the child cannot go out and play with their friends. So that is a kind of a removal punishment. Presentation punishment would be, say for example, some child has done something wrong and the parent comes and punishes the child, physically beats up the child. So this is a presentation kind of a punishment where something aversive has been added in the environment to reduce or suppress the behavior. So this is basically, and both presentation and removal punishment, they are basically about it's basically about introducing or taking away of her so that child feels bad about it. So, and the idea is to not, that this behavior should not happen again in future. So, reduce the possibility or probability of an aversive behavior happening again in future. So, we have two punishments. So, being teachers, we need to understand that punishments do not work very well with the students in the long run. At one point of time, the children or students, they may be afraid or scared of punishments, but in the long run, they do not work very well. So, being teachers, we have to make use of the positive and the negative reinforcements in order to foster or in order to motivate the children to learn the things which we would want them to learn. Okay. Now, another things which we need to do is, or other skills that we, these, this is basically about how do we motivate and bring about motivation in the classroom. We can have skill-based teaching. Now, skills are, these are teaching skills. If we follow in the class, we can have a very good, we can have students who can do very well with the learning part. Say, skill of introducing a topic. So, this is a skill which talks about how can we introduce a topic, in what different ways can we introduce a topic. Skill of questioning. Skill of questioning is basically about how do we put up questions, what kind of questions, what level of questions, higher order questions, lower order questions, middle order questions. So, what kind of questions and what should be the frequency of the question? Okay. So, this, it talks about the questioning. Then we have the skill of response management or probing questions. Say for example, if I have asked a question, the student has given me a wrong answer. Now, what do I do? Student has given me an incomplete answer. What do I do then? A student has not given me any answer. or a completely wrong answer, or the student has given me a very good correct answer. So probing questions or response management is about basically how do I manage the responses of students. Then we have skill of stimulus variation, the same things which we have discussed under variation of stimuli through you can say the audiovisual switching, interaction style, etc., etc. Skill of using reinforcement, as we have already discussed, positive and negative reinforcement. So we can make use of positive and negative reinforcement. Skill of explanation, which tells us how do we explain, what there are certain points which are to be kept in mind for explaining, and we need to keep those things in mind. Skill of using illustrations and examples, we cannot make use of any examples. The examples have to be meaningful examples, and it should make things simpler and easier. Skill of using chalkboard, which is very important. Many of the teachers do not know how to use a chalkboard. So this talks about in what manner can we make use of the chalkboard in a very, very effective manner. And skill of attaining closure. It shouldn't be like the bell has rung and the teacher runs out of the classroom. There has to be a proper closure. So how do we do that? This skill talks about that. Now, these are some of the few other effective strategies which can motivate or bring about great level of motivation in the classroom. Variety of tasks. As we discussed, there should be variety of tasks, collaborative tasks, individual based tasks, teacher controlled environments should be there, students controlled environments. Use of collaborative and cooperative environments, teacher's own motivation. Now, a motivated teacher can only motivate her students. An unmotivated teacher can never foster learning among her students. So the teacher herself or himself has to be very, very motivated. Use of ICT, it generally helps because students are, breaks the monotony and it makes things more easier and interesting. Use of innovative and varied methods of teaching. As we discussed, we need to have different methods of teaching and the rapport of the teacher with the students has to be good. Students, if they have a rapport with the teacher, they feel happy to learn those things, and it has been experiences of many students. Students, if they have a personal kind of a rapport with one teacher, they are more interested in that subject area rather than teachers where they don't feel connected. So it's basically about connecting, making connections between the teachers and the students. In the end, I would like to tell all of you, be happy and stay motivated. Now, students, in this particular session, we spoke about the personality. What is personality, and two most important facets of personality, very important facets of personality, that is the self-concept and motivation, and how or what is the role of teachers in developing of self-concept and how to motivate our students for teaching learning experiences. Thank you, and I wish all the very best to you.